मोहम्मद तुम्हारे मुंह कहीं तक चला आएगा।
Assalaamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakaatuhu. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wal aqibatu lil muttaqeen, was salatu was salamu ala rasulihi al kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'een amma ba'd. I welcome each and every single one of you to the end of the year program for Inc. Foundation. Unfortunately, we weren't able to have an on-site graduation ceremony, or jalsa as it is known. This is the norm for higher Islamic institutes of learning and madaris around the world. InshaAllah, it is postponed for a later, more suitable date. Nevertheless, everyone who is tuning in and joining our program via the different social media platforms, we welcome each and every single one of you. We begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for allowing us and giving us the ability to engage in teaching and learning his deen and teaching and learning the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the course of the past year. Inshallah, Mufti Abdullah Ijaz will be detailing all the different activities after the keynote speeches. Nevertheless, we thank all the teachers, all the students, all the parents, all the supporters and the affiliates of Inc. Foundation who have sent their children, who supported us throughout the entire past year in the various programs that Inc. Foundation has offered. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward each and every single one of you in this dunya and in the hereafter. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us and our families the best of this dunya and the akhirah. Inshallah, without further ado, we begin the program. I would like to invite Hafiz Mudathir Khan. Inshallah, he will render us with the recitation of the Qur'an.
Assalaamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakaatuhu. Inshallah, I'll be reciting a portion from Surah Ibrahim. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ قال إبراهيم رب اجعل هذا البلد آمنا واجنبني وبني أن نعبد الأصنام رب إنهن أضللن كثيرا من الناس فمن تبعني فإنه مني ومن عصاني فإنك غفور رحيم ربنا بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم ربنا ليقيموا الصلاة فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم وارزقهم من الثمرات لعلهم يشكرون ربنا إنك تعلم ما نخفي وما نعلن وما يخفى على الله من شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي وهبني على الكبر إسماعيل وإسحاق إن ربي لسميع الدعاء رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب صدق الله العظيم جزاكم الله خيرا
Jazaakallahu Khaira, Hafiz Mujassir Khan. What an amazing and beautiful recitation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow Hafiz Mujassir Khan to continue in his studies. And Hafiz Mujassir Khan was reciting those ayats regarding Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and Prophet Ismail alayhi salam. And as we are going through these days of Dhul Hijjah, it's a great reminder for each and every single one of us that the sacrifices that Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam he went through. And in each and every single one of those sacrifices, he stayed committed to the deen. He stayed committed to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to commit ourselves to the deen completely and to use us for the service of his deen. Hafiz Mujassir Khan, alhamdulillah, recently completed his hifz under Inc. Foundation's tahfiz program and under our beloved teacher, Mawla Umair Damat Barakaatuhu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless Hafiz Mujassir Khan and Mawla Umair and reward them tremendously. Inshallah, next we have Mufti Azimuddin Ahmad. Before I would like to call our honorable guest, Mufti Azimuddin Ahmad, is very important that we know how special of a person we have today who will be rendering us with some beautiful advices. Mufti Azimuddin Ahmad is, alhamdulillah, a director of Masjid Darus Salam, which is located in Lombard, Illinois. Darus Salam is a premier institute of higher and primary Islamic learning in the USA. And alhamdulillah, they are setting a trend of how traditional knowledge and contemporary practice and approach are blended. They are setting a model for all communities to follow. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for them in each and every single one of their goals. Inshallah, I call upon Mufti Azimuddin Ahmad.
اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى ال سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم وفي صحبه صلى الله عليه وسلم امري وحل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا اما بعد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى قل هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون إنما يتذكر أولو الألباب وقال تعالى من كان يريد حرث الآخرة نزل له في حرثه ومن كان يريد حرث الدنيا نؤتيه منها وما له في الآخرة من نصيب صدق الله العظيم Respected elders and brothers, mothers and sisters, dear listeners, dear students of knowledge Assalaamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh I am honored and grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the staff and the founders of Inc. Foundation for inviting me for this virtual special program. And alhamdulillah, with the presence of esteemed scholars, as great as Mufti Ibrahim Sahab, mashallah, and Qari Zahid Sahab, etc., there was no need for me to be present, but this was the insistence of our dear Mufti Abdullah, who asked me to say a few words. So I was obliged to do so, inshallah, and I hope that Allah allows myself to benefit and the others to benefit, inshallah, from whatever is mentioned and shared. Dear friends, in the era that we are currently living in, and this is truly a very unique era that is, we do not know how long it will last and how long this fitna will cover the world. This is nothing less than a fitna, nothing less than a massive dahiya, musiba, difficulty for the entire ummah in their terms of their deen, in terms of their dunya as well. But the work of deen must carry on, must continue, no matter what happens. Just today, just a few minutes ago, when I completed my dhuhr salah here in Chicago, it just thought crossed my mind that as I'm standing 6 feet away from my nearest musalli in the saf, I just thought it came across my mind that, you know, how we were so particular when we used to say istawu, atadilu, tarasu, sujudul khalal, make sure your heels are on the line, stand shoulder to shoulder, and next to each other, make sure there's no gaps. And we used to talk about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if there are gaps in between, then your hearts will become crooked and shaitan will find a way amongst you and he will turn you against one another. And that was the norm that's been going on for, you know, centuries and centuries and centuries. And we were so particular about these things in our masajid. And today, due to, of course, the measures that we have to take in order to keep our masajid safe, and ulama have given permission for it, but nonetheless, it's a very unique reality that now there's massive spaces between ourselves and others. And what is the unintended effect of that, and the unintended effect of most masjids around the country and other parts of the world being still closed and not open for Jummah or very limited capacity, not open for Eid or very limited capacity, and with all sorts of different regulations, is that the ummah is becoming fragmented. The ummah is becoming disconnected from one another. The ummah is getting disconnected from the masjid. I'm seeing this in my own community. I'm seeing this in other communities, that as many online programs as we're trying to keep, it really does not substitute the presence of the people coming to the house of Allah, praying salah together, sitting in a gathering of dhikr or dua or ta'aleem afterwards. It does not substitute that. So we are trying our best to fill in the gaping hole, but we are not able to do so. And if we do not realize that, then we are in a bigger problem. At least we need to realize we're going through a crisis. We need to realize that if we or our family is not connected to the masjid on a daily basis, on a regular basis, and we are not able to do the dini activities that we're involved before, that this will have lasting effects on our deen, lasting effects on our generations. Generations seriously will pay the price for the mistakes that we may end up making right now. And mistakes, sometimes in our communities, there really is no option. Everything's closed down. But then we have to figure out, like, how can we do something outside of the masjid? How can we do something outside of the large Islamic center, but still congregate in a safe manner and still do the effort of deen, still have a halaqat of ilm and dhikr, and so forth. And if our community has a masjid or has a madrasa that is open, that is running, then if we do not take benefit of that, and that is one of the, you know, a huge loss that our family is going to incur, simply because, you know, we are going to work, we are going shopping, we're going all these places, etc., wearing our masks and so forth. But if we do not go to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or our students do not study the deen because of this fear, without taking the protective measures, then this is a very big loss for us. So this zamana and this era of fitna that we're in right now, in which we are disconnected from the house of Allah and disconnected from the effort of deen, we are being tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is seeing how are we going to act in this scenario, in this situation. If we regroup and we figure out what is the best way that we can preserve our deen, then inshallah we will succeed. The fitnas are just beginning. The fitna of Dajjal, has begun. Not the actual Dajjal, but we're definitely in the Dajjali era. And the materialism is at all a high right now. And the indulgence and fuhsh and indecent things are all-time high. All of these things are there. And our youth and our women and men are being attracted and being pulled in all directions towards sin. And the effort of deen is at an all-time low. The effort of da'wah and tabligh, effort of khanqahs, effort of madaris, pretty much is almost done. India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, all these famous countries that had millions of students of knowledge, millions of people out in effort of da'wah and tabligh, hundreds of thousands in the khanqahs, everything has come to a standstill. And let's not think that that's not going to leave a lasting effect on the entire ummah. Of course it is. Like the presence changed the world, the absence of it will also change the world. So we have to now wake up and become extremely vigilant for our deen. Every man has to be thinking about his own family first and foremost. How am I going to take care? I cannot bank on the local Islamic center, the local khanqah, the local tablighi markaz, the local other madrasa, which may not be there. I have to figure out how can I change and keep my children and my spouse and myself on track. So every madrasa and every house has to become a madrasa, every house has to become a masjid, every house has to become a khanqa, every house has to become a think tank where we are thinking for the effort of deen. Dear brothers and sisters, I thought myself, maybe, you know, after Ramadan things will ease up, or, you know, but we're with the second wave taking place in this country, and many, many states, more than half of the states possibly going to lockdown, and many states receiving the highest and, you know, record-breaking number of COVID cases, we're obviously seeing that we're going backwards now. So we can't do much about that besides, you know, wearing our masks fully and being washing our hands and being protective of ourselves and our family members. That, inshallah, hopefully we're all doing it. For now, we need to start doing that. We need to take that seriously. But then we also need to realize that, you know, we cannot be relaxed and think that, okay, this will end. Abi, it's okay. We'll start our dini effort, inshallah, in 2 months' time, 3 months' time. Right? It's already been 5 months. How many more months are we going to wait? So I advise myself and all of us here that in these days of Dhul Hijjah that we are in, half of the days have already gone, we need to create an environment of reciting Quran at home, fasting at home, dua at home, dhikr at home, and crying at home, and muhalaqat of ta'aleem at home, whatever level we can. If we do not do that, then we will start losing very quickly, very, very quickly, our youth and ourselves, actually, because of the lack of environment. This is the first thing I would like to mention. Second thing, my dear brothers and sisters, is that this deen will continue. It's about whether you and I are going to stick to it or not. The deen will happen, the deen will continue. Whether you and I will be part of it is the question. So make sure that if we can be a part of a sub-deeni effort, mashallah, for example, Institute of Noble Knowledge is doing great work, alhamdulillah, for the past few years in the region, the Baltimore region, whatnot. And I'm so happy, mashallah, that work is such a huge need in that area. And under the leadership of Mufti Abdullah and his colleagues, they've done such a great work in terms of connecting different ulama and getting them into positions and places of khidmah throughout the area. And along with that, the, you know, getting, take care of the Jummah khutbahs and whatnot. This is a tawfiq from Allah. This is tawfiq from Allah. This is something that is, inshallah, going to succeed. This is something that's going to, you know, it's a stock that's going up. I truly feel, whoever local brothers and sisters are listening, that you need to invest right now. If you haven't already done so, invest it with your best daughters and sons. Invest it with your wealth. Invest it with your time. What we don't realize is that not all of us can go change the world. And actually, none of us can change the world on our own. We need people with us. I remember my teacher, Maulana Shabir Saluji, one day he mentioned to me after graduation, many years after graduation, he was saying that if an alim, no matter how talented he is, if he does not have the right group of helpers with him, then no matter how talented and amazing he may be, unfortunately, he will not be able to do much. And if you don't have all the talent in the world, but you are surrounded by a good group of caring, dedicated, sincere people, you can achieve amazing things. So what these institutes require are people like ourselves who do not only send their kids, but spend their energy and resources into it. Just like we make fikr for our bedroom, our house, our kitchen, our lawn, if anything breaks or anything goes wrong, we are worried about fixing it and making it look nice, etc. We want it to look nice. How much effort people put on the landscaping, how much effort people put on the exterior of the house, even though we don't even see that. But no, when someone is passing by, it should look nice and adorable and clean and inviting. That's where we put all this effort. So, mashallah, even a tenth of that effort, if we put into the madrasa and put into the masjids in our community, alhamdulillah, you'll see they'll flourish. The sky is the limit. There's so much work to do, And the ulama do not have that. Obviously, they're not superhuman. Right? They're not angels. They require assistance and help. And they need talented minds. They need talents of various people, IT people, people who have good writing skills, people who have good thinking skills, people who have good marketing skills, people who have good fundraising skills, people who have good management skills. All of those people, if we come and put our resources together, inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala, this ink and all the other institutions can thrive. But if we simply utilize these places for our service, for their service to come, I'm going to get my son to do his maktab there. My daughter will do her hifz there. My son will go in the morning 4 or 5 hours instead and come back. Then my brothers and sisters, we're not doing, you know, we're not doing nusah. We're not being well wishers for the institution. And not for the institution, but the deen. The deen, we have to remember that by sending our son and daughter to a madrasa, we're not doing ihsan upon that institution. We are not doing any favor. Instead, we are benefiting. When someone gets their son admitted into Harvard or John Hopkins, do they feel like they're doing a favor to John Hopkins and Harvard by sending their son there? Even if you have to pay some outrageous tuition of 70, 80K a year, would happily you take loans or you do all sorts of other things at $80,000 a year paying for medical school. And people feel honored. We'll go around the whole town telling everyone, you know what, my daughter got matched into John Hopkins residency or my son got accepted to Harvard. We'll tell everyone about that. And we will never think that we're doing ihsan upon Harvard. We'll feel so indebted to the school that they accepted my lowly son, even though he might be great, but he had competition. MashaAllah, and yet, you know, we're so gracious, and we feel so indebted to the gracious efforts of Harvard and John Hopkins that they accepted our son and daughter. My dear friends, are our local madrasas and our local masjids and ma'ahid and institutions, what do we think of them? Let's ask ourselves, what do we think of them? When we send our children there, do we think that we are doing ihsan upon the madrasa that we gave our son for? Why we gave it? You know deep down that your son and daughter's life is changing when they go to the madrasa. Their tarbiyat has changed. Their akhlaq has changed. They become better sons and daughters. They will become better husbands and daughters, husbands and wives. They will become better citizens. They will become better Muslims. And they will be able to serve the community, and you'll get the sadaqah jariyah for it. So we should feel genuinely indebted that alhamdulillah, you have sincere teachers from morning to evening sitting there working and molding our sons and daughters, that we could not make an effort. Many times, my dear brothers, my own experience in the madrasa has been that parents come and they look at, if they have four kids, the two kids that are doing good in the dunya, and they're okay in the deen, they will not send them even accidentally to the madrasa, especially the intelligent ones. And then the two kids that are not doing good in the deen, and of course they're not doing good, more importantly, in the dunya, and they're becoming a headache for the parents. Then the parents keep on saying, bye, please, please take this kid. You know, he needs your help. He needs your assistance. And those two kids, mashallah, who are very intelligent and amazing, and they're outstanding, and their tarbiyat is done as well, but it would be very beneficial for them to come study a little bit of deen. They feel reluctant. They refuse, rather, to send them. So madrasa is not really for just a place for people who you feel that they are no good and they can't help you at home and they are failing in school and university, that we send them madrasa. You know, I remember a long time ago, Sheikh Hamza Yusuf made a statement. He said, garbage in and garbage out. And he was talking about the fact that many madrasas and many universities throughout the Arab world, and he's speaking about his experience there, and we can talk about our experience in India and Pakistan and Bangladesh and other in the subcontinent, that parents, you look at, you know, and they send the lula langra, the kid who can't do anything, they send him to the madrasa. And you can't deny that. That's exactly what happened. Few people who are talented in deen and dunya, and who had a very bright future in dunya, their parents sent him to the madrasa. Most of them were not like that. Mona Sharitani Rahmatullah even writes about that. He talks about that the wealthy and the rich and the accomplished ones need to start sending their sons and daughters to the madrasa, right? At least their sons. And if we want some genuine change. So that's a sacrifice that the ummah needs to make. We have to start demanding sacrifice from ourselves and our communities, not just the sacrifice of donations, I'm saying, of money, which is obviously very important. But beyond that, we have to choose our brightest minds. We have to choose our best assets, which are our brightest minds, and send them to the deen. My dear friends, we are living in a time of fitna. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Allah says in Hadith al-Qudsi, بِحَلَفْتُ لَأُتِيحَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ فِتْنَةً يَصِيرُ الْحَلِيبُ فِيهَا حَيْرَانًا. I take an oath. I take an oath by my being that I will send down such a fitna upon the ummah. I will send down such a fitna upon the ummah that the most intelligent of people will become completely perplexed and worried and will have no idea how to go about solving those crises. So we need intelligent people, smart people from your homes to be dedicated to the deen, connected to the madrasa. And inshallah, along with the dunyawi education they have, they will bring amazing honor to yourself, to your family, to Islam, to deen, and to the Muslims. That is my request. Please look for your brightest minds and send them part-time, full-time, whatever you can, hour a day, full-time to the madrasa. And number two, beyond, donate generously, and beyond that, also give your, you know, input. Don't just give opinions and run away. That doesn't help, okay? All the time. That's very easy to come give opinion and then leave. Give the opinion and say, you know what, I think we should put this sign over here. And Mufti Sahib will say, mashallah, that's great. Then go and purchase a sign and come back and hang it up. How many other things are the idara people going to be doing? They're teaching all day, all night, and they're worried about all the other aspects of it. Alhamdulillah, if Allah put in your mind something, that's great. Don't keep it to yourself. Don't, if there's something wrong, also I may say, if you feel the madrasa is doing something inappropriate or incorrect, then my dear friend, my dear brother, my dear sister, don't keep it to yourself. That is not nusha, that is not being a well-wisher. Go tell them, this is what I think, you know, I heard people saying this. I think we can improve like this. I'm not sure about the decision you made. Can you reconsider it? We need people like that who care, who love, who are not just using a madrasa, use and throw. Madrasa is not a toilet paper, a use and throw. No, you respect it, care for it, love it, and look after the way more than you love and look after your own house. Anything you see wrong, anything needs to be corrected, go and say, this is what I think, you know, this is your opinion. And they, all the people will be very appreciative of your input, and they will be appreciative of your feedback. And as long as you're coming with a sincere advice, we can give constructive criticism. That is also good. But the purpose of it should be that how can I help? Not that how can I bring this place down? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you and I the ability to serve the deen in all times that we are facing. No matter what time comes our way, may Allah keep you and I steadfast, our family steadfast, our sons and daughters, our wives and our husbands steadfast in the deen, and allow us to remain connected to the effort of deen in whatever form possible until our last breath. Jazakumullah khaira once again for giving us this opportunity to share these few words. If it was beneficial indeed from Allah, if the mistakes were made, then it was from my own nafs and shaitan, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness for that. Jazakumullah khaira. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakumullah khair, Mufti Azimuddin. Alhamdulillah, we were blessed to have him. Like I said before, Darul Salam is an institute which offers various programs, and alhamdulillah, Mufti Sahib took out his precious time for us. You know, if I were to just list some of his programs, the list would be very long. We, you know, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant Mufti Sahib the himma and the courage to continue making khidmat of deen with the afiyat, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept him. Also, a quick reminder, in the description below, we have few links for the different organizations that the people who, the brothers and sisters who are listening to, they can donate to, inshallah. Nevertheless, we thank Mufti Azimuddin for joining us and giving us his precious time and beautiful advices. Inshallah, I call upon Mufti Abdullah Ajaz, who is the director of Ink Foundation.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihil kareem. Huwa uswatun hasanatun lil muslimin wa rahmatun lil alameen. Wa nashhadu an la ilaha illallah, albirul kareem, ar-ra'uf rahim. Wa nashhadu anna sayyidina wa nabiyyana wa maulana muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu wa khaliluhu al-hadi ila siratul mustaqim. أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولو أن أهل القرى آمنوا واتقوا لفتحنا عليهم بركات من السماء والأرض ولكن كذبوا فأخذناهم بما كانوا يكسبون وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم العلماء ورثة الأنبياء وكما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. Respected ulama ikram, my dear asatidha, colleagues, parents, students, I begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most gracious and most merciful, and a sincere salutation upon the beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family and his companions ajma'in. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the ability in whatever capacity that we are able to have a program, you are able to have some sort of interaction wherein we can benefit from the scholars, we can benefit from each other, inshallah. As Mufti Hanif mentioned in the introduction, that this is just a program, an end-of-year program, but inshallah, the jalsa, the actual jalsa, will take place at a later date, and inshallah, with the correct spirit, with the correct ruhaniya, and the appropriate setting of a jalsa and graduation ceremony, where we can celebrate the accomplishments and achievements of the students, and we can mark that special occasion, inshallah ta'ala, at a later, more suitable date, when circumstances are lifted and when things, inshallah, get back to normal, if not better. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us safe and healthy until that time. In a few minutes, and although I don't have a lot of time, but I would like to briefly cover some of the activities, some of the history of Inc. Foundation, just so we have a better understanding and a better idea. And inshallah, we can continue to support in whatever capacity we can. So Inc. Foundation is an organization we started a few years ago, but in the past year, we were able to officially have our own space. Inc. stands for Institute of Noble Knowledge, which in Arabic is Idaratul Ilm al-Sharif, Institution of Noble Knowledge. And we began in 2017. I believe there's some issue with the mic. We begin in 2017 with, alhamdulillah, a few ulama relocating from the different areas, relocating from New Jersey, New York, Chicago, other places, and coming and settling in the Baltimore area. And alhamdulillah, with that we begin our different programs. This was the start of the Tarbiyah program. The Tarbiyah program is essentially a primary maktab learning for students from the first grade till the 12th grade, wherein a student is able to become proficient in Qur'an, recitation, and tajweed, and learn the basics of fiqh, seerah, ahadith, aqidah, so on and so forth. The reason for this program cannot be understated. It cannot be undermined, the efforts of this program and the results of it. Alhamdulillah, we have seen in our travels throughout the world that this is the backbone of the community, that when a strong maktab system and tarbiyah system is established in the community, then it generates the Muslimin, the brothers and sisters, practicing Muslim brothers and sisters as it is required in the community to progress and to enhance the community. And secondly, it revolutionizes the area wherein not just ulama and leaders are practicing, but every single person, every single Muslim brother and sister becomes a practicing Muslim brother and sister. And due to that, there are initiatives, there are...
Assalamu alaikum, guys. Since the Zoom audio is cutting, please tune in through YouTube and then you can watch the slideshow through Zoom. Jazaakallahu Khaira.
Yes, if anyone is finding a hard time listening to the audio, bismillah, please join the YouTube link. So, alhamdulillah, we begin that tarbiyah program. The next year, we begin a tahfidh program. And then the year after, we begin in 2019, just about a year ago, we launched our space in Ellicott City. And alhamdulillah, we've been conducting programs from last year until this year, even through COVID, through the different interruptions in our program. But alhamdulillah, we are continuing to run today. Some of the advisors and mushirs of Inc. Foundation, first and foremost, our Shaykh al-Hadith, Mawlana Fadhl Rahman al-A'zami, Hafidhahum Allah Ta'ala. Mawlana Fadhl Rahman is my Shaykh. He's also my Shaykh al-Hadith, taught us Sahih al-Bukhari. And he is someone we frequently discuss, seek matters of advice from. The second is Shaykh al-Hadith, Mufti Ibrahim Desai, Hafidhahum Allah Ta'ala. Mufti Ibrahim will be joining us shortly, inshallah. And Mufti Ibrahim Desai is a world-renowned scholar. Many of us have probably heard his name. And he is someone who is known throughout the world and globally for his fatawa and for his service to the community. Then is Qari Muhammad Zahid, who is our my HIFS teacher and who is local to the Baltimore area. Wallahu alam, but there may not be a single Muslim family in the area who has not heard of Qari Muhammad Zahid and has dedicated service to the deen as well. The next is our Asatiz of Darul Uloom New York. Alhamdulillah, we frequently contact them time to time. Mawlana Yameen Sahib, Daun Barakaatuhu, Mawlana Mikael Sahib, Mawlana Suhail, Mawlana Imtiaz, and the others. And they continue to bless us with their advice and also come and do programs as well. And last but not least, I would like to thank and appreciate the continued support and efforts of my father, Dr. Muhammad Ijaz, Daun Barakaatuhu. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a long life filled with afiyah, filled with amal al-salih. Both my parents have been, alhamdulillah, very supportive of this initiative, of this program. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue them with khair and with afiyah, inshaAllah. Our location is currently in Ellicott City. It is an office space and a suite that we have rented out. And due to the expansion, we will continue to expand into the next suite as well. And this is a temporary setup. We are continuing to look to purchase our own independent property, inshallah, where we can grow and develop the madrasa. Some of the ulama and teachers of Inc. Foundation are myself, Abdullah Ijaz, Mufti Sayyid Hanif Ahmed, who is also the resident scholar and Imam Darul Taqwa. We are joined by Mawlana Mahbub Rahman, Qari Tamam, Mawlana Umar Siddiqui, Mawlana Tashif Hussain, Mawlana Arifuddin, and several other ulama who inshallah will be onboarding as full-time, Mawlana Saad Anis, Mawlana Saifullah Asad, Mawlana Justin Poe, Mawlana Sibatullah Ahmed. And alhamdulillah, we've also been able to connect with ulama in other states and other communities. And so far, we also established a branch of Inc. Foundation known as Inc. Dallas. Mawlana Uthman Muhammad is the director of Inc. Dallas, and he is continuing programs there as well. Mufti Ruhullah Bayanzai from California, Mufti Saad Haq from Virginia, Mufti Bilal Shabir. These are all ulama, and others such as Mufti Abdul Rashid, Masoodi, Mufti Suhail Randera, have all joined in some capacity, either as teachers, khatibs, imams, or affiliated with Inc. in some form of fashion. We ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant all of them jaza'i khair, and grant them the best in dunya and akhirah, and grant them the best in all their efforts. There are some of the ulama. The name of Inc. is derived from a poem which our Shaykh al-Hadith Mawlana Fadl Rahman al-A'zami would have us memorize at the beginning of the Dora Hadith, the last year of our Alamiya studies. And the line and the bait is, وَمِدَادُ مَا تَجْرِي بِهِ أَقْلَامُهُمْ أَزْكَى وَأَفْضَلْ مِنْ دَمِ الشُّهَدَى. And this is, we've adopted this as our slogan as well. And the translation, although the meaning is very deep, is the ink that flows from their pens is purer and greater than the blood of martyrs. This cannot be understated, the value of ulama, and how much ulama are needed to the community as well. Moving on,
Translation, although the meaning is very deep, is the ink that flows from the pen is purer and greater than the blood of martyrs. This cannot be understated, the value of ulama.
Sorry for the interruption. Our student body is comprised of the different sections, which is the Alamiya program, the Tahfidh program, the Tarbiyah program. Alhamdulillah, we offer 8 programs, 4 full-time and 4 part-time. We have the full-time Alamiya program. This full-time Alamiya program is the only one in the state of Maryland. We also have the full-time Tahfidh. We have the full-time Nadhra and Tarbiyah. And then we also have all of these programs and part-time as well. And we offer homeschooling from grade 1 to 12 and various programs, alhamdulillah. The student body, we have a total of about 8 full-time teachers. And alhamdulillah, on Inc. location, on the Inc. site, they've been, alhamdulillah, 110 plus students have registered and enrolled. And inshallah, we ask that these numbers continue to increase and grow with khair and afiyah, inshallah, so we're able to affect and influence and able to change the community, inshallah. Also, the part-time programs and the halaqat that we're able to do in the other communities, we're able to integrate in the different communities and the different masajids. So far, about 30 plus masajids in the Maryland state, we've been able to do some sort of program. The first institute I would like to recognize is Bayan Academy. Alhamdulillah, they offer online virtual homeschooling from grade 6 to 12. They are our homeschooling department. It is a very, very good program. It is a program which, alhamdulillah, many of our students and parents and others in the community have enjoyed tremendously. They do a great job of communication, a great job of teaching. Alhamdulillah, very professional setup. Al-Ilm Association of Masjid Quba is another masjid, alhamdulillah, which we send our scholars to for khutbahs and for the maktab program as well, and we're able to collaborate on other community efforts and extracurricular activities such as soccer tournaments and swimming classes and so on and so forth. There are many more masajid: Masjid Mustafa, Marhaba Dawah Center, Masjid Zamzam, Harford Islamic Center, Salisbury, the Marvel Muslim Community, Waldorf Mosque, and many, many others. Alhamdulillah, the list would be too long. Randallstown Islamic Center as well. And in all of these different venues, alhamdulillah, I've been able to teach and interact with several hundred students in all of these different venues, alhamdulillah. We thank all of the leadership of those masajid for allowing us the opportunity to come and benefit the community. Also, with the other ulama in the DMV area, we are working on creating and establishing an ulama body. Alhamdulillah, the DMV Ulama Council has been formed, and we will be offering initiatives for the betterment of the community, such as a halal certification and monitoring committee, a Darul Ifta, a Hilal chapter, which is citing the moon, counseling and marital issues will also be, services will be provided, a systemized regional maktab, inshallah, will be set up. So all of these programs, Alhamdulillah, Inc. is heavily involved in, and we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to do these programs for His sake. I would like to conclude with this, that all of this we're doing is with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Him we praise, and with the du'as of our respected teachers, in the support of all of the parents, the students, and well-wishers of Inc. and everyone involved. We ask all of you to please continue to make du'a for us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide all of us and grant us qabuliyah, acceptance, grant us sincerity, grant us istiqamah, steadfastness, grant us afia, easiness, and barakah. Ameen. Some of the upcoming programs, which especially for the all the parents and students, is inshallah, we will be beginning admissions in mid-August, and we will also be rolling out full-time programs for boys and girls, adding other programs. So the full-time tahfidh will be open for both boys and girls, full-time alimiyah for both boys and girls, as well as a part-time alimiyah, tahfidh, tarbiyah for boys and girls, and homeschooling for boys and girls as well. And inshallah, other activities we are planning, and other collaboration with other masajid and other venues as well. So once again, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the ability to continue with ikhlas and istiqamah. We thank all of the scholars who have joined us, and inshallah, I would like to introduce Mufti Ebrahim Desai. I think it's very important. Although Mufti Sahib is a very humble personality, alhamdulillah, Mufti Ebrahim Desai is our direct ifta teacher, someone who we spent 2 years with, learning from his teachings and enjoying his company. And Mufti Sahib is, he needs no introduction. He is one of the most world-renowned muftis and ulama in this day and age. Mufti Ebrahim Desai, his Ask Imam website and fatwa service and portal has been operating for close to 2 decades and serving the entire world. If you just go to the Ask Imam website, you can see the different countries where the questions pour in from. And in my time there, I also received queries from different parts of the world, some countries I didn't even know existed before. And Mufti Ebrahim, mashallah, has been doing this for many, many years. And subhanAllah, one of the things which I did not realize before I had joined the Darul Ifta was how many other efforts and how many other ventures and endeavors Mufti Ibrahim Desai, Damat Barakaatuhu, is involved in. Mufti Sahib also teaches Sahih al-Bukhari in not just one but two madaris. Mufti Sahib is also part of the Jamiat al-Ulama KZN, the local ulama body. Mufti Ibrahim Desai also does programs, weekly programs in multiple venues on very interesting, very riveting, very beneficial topics such as Kitab al-Buyu from Sahih al-Bukhari, other Islamic programs, Tazkiyah and Islahi programs. So this is only a little bit of, you know, a little introduction of Mufti Ibrahim Desai, but I do not have the capacity nor the ability to introduce Mufti Sahib as he should be. But we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant Mufti Sahib a long life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant Mufti Sahib shadow and supervision above us for a very long time. Grant him a life full of amal al-salih, full of afiyah, full of khair. Alhamdulillah, we are joined by Mufti Ibrahim Desai now. I would like to request Mufti Ibrahim if he can please advise us for a few moments, inshallah. Mufti Sahib, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum, Mufti Sahib. Assalamu alaikum, Mufti Sahib.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazaakallahu Khaira, Mufti Sahib, for joining us. Alhamdulillah, I just listed some of Mufti Sahib's activities and mashallah, the amount of benefit we've picked up from Mufti Sahib's sohbah. And inshallah, the brothers and sisters are waiting for Mufti Sahib to address us, inshallah.
Jazaakallahu Khaira. Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد من الله على المؤمنين إذ بعث فيهم رسولا من أنفسهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين علمنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا الدعاء اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا وعملا متقبلا ورزقا حلالا طيبا وشفاء من كل داء صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم Most respected ulama, students, parents, elder than friends, mother than sister than Islam, and all the people that are listening to this program. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I've recited before you verse 164 of Surah Ali Imran, which is in the third juz of the Qur'an al-Kareem. The background of the contents of this verse is, prior to the coming of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the environment of the Arabs was infested and saturated with all forms of evil. Killing and looting was the order of the day. Drinking wine and alcohol was the norm of the society. Women were degenerated to something cheaper than a commodity. Almighty Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala refers to this evil environment prior to coming Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran al-Kareem. وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ
prior to the coming of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, people were in open deviation. Not just any deviation, clear open deviation. Almighty Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala favored the Arabs specifically and the ummah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam at large by sending Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and bringing about a revolution, a metamorphosis in such an infested and saturated environment. Those that used to kill and loot, now, after the teaching of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they began respecting the sanctity of life. Just one verse of the Quran, the Kareem, brought about a change and a revolution in them to understand the respect and the sanctity of life. Man ahyaha faka'annama ahya an-nasa jami'a. That person that gives life to one soul, irrespective of who the soul may be. It could be a Muslim or a non-Muslim. It could be black or white. It could be from any caste, color, and creed. The sanctity of life is so important that you give life to one soul, it is as though you have given life to all of mankind. This one verse alone instilled in the heart of the Sahaba the respect and sanctity of life. Those people that used to drink wine and alcohol, they understood the benefit of exercise and restraint. And again, it was just one verse of the Quran Kareem that took them out of the centuries of addiction. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu innama al-khamr ridsun. Aw kama qal. O you who believe, Allah appeals to the iman of the believers. Drinking wine and alcohol is filth, it is dirt. Women were now being respected and valued. Again, it was just one verse of the Quran Kareem, just two words of the Quran Kareem that brought about a revolution in the hearts of the men that believed in the greatness and honor of women. وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. And live with them, live with the women folk with principle and respect. This revolution, this metamorphosis, the change in an environment, it came about through three missions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Almighty Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran Kareem, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Almighty Allah tabarak wa ta'ala favored the believers when he sent a Rasul among them. And then Almighty Allah tabarak wa ta'ala refers to three missions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first mission, Yatlu alayhim ayati, recite the verses of the Quran Kareem before the people. The second mission, Wayuzakkihim, to cleanse and purify the people, take them out from wrong aqidah, wrong belief, wrong philosophy, wrong ideology, and to cleanse the soul, instill it with pure values. Wayuallimuhumul kitaba wal hikmah, and teach the people the kitab, the Quran Kareem, and wisdom. That is the sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It was through the tilawat of the Quran Kareem, it was through the recitation of the ayat of the Quran, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to do the work, noble work of da'wat and tabligh. It was through tazkiyah, cleansing and purifying the soul, that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spiritualized the people. It was through ta'aleem and ta'allum, imparting knowledge, teaching and acquiring knowledge, that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instilled in the people the educational values of the ummah. Now, each one of these three missions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were equally important. Just as da'wah and tabligh is important, likewise, tazkiyah, cleansing and purifying the soul is equally important. And just as da'wah and tabligh, cleansing and purifying the souls are important, education, imparting knowledge and acquiring knowledge is equally important. If a person believed in each one of these three missions of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he practices on them, or he supports each one of the three missions, it complements what he is doing. If a person is actually actively involved in the work of da'wah and tabligh, but he supports tazkiyah, or what we know as the hanka system, if a person is actively involved in the work of da'wah and tabligh, but he supports and understands the importance of imparting knowledge, acquiring knowledge, it enhances his work in da'wah and tabligh. If a person is actively involved in the work of tasawwuf, in the work of hanka, but he also supports the work of da'wah and tabligh and education, it enhances his own spirituality. And if a person is engaged actively imparting knowledge and acquiring knowledge, but he also supports da'wah and tabligh, he also supports tazkiyah and cleansing of the soul, then that enhances his knowledge and he gets a true understanding of knowledge. We should always adopt a very balanced view in Shariat. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has advised us, khairul umur awsatuha. The best approach in anything is a very balanced approach. We don't adopt an extremist approach, neither do we adopt a negligent approach. We would follow what the sunnah of Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam taught us. If da'wah and tabligh is the sunnah of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we do it. If tazkiyah and cleansing of the soul was done by Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we do it. That was the mission, we do it. And if education, acquiring knowledge and imparting knowledge is a sunnah and the mission of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we would do it. We would take part in each one of the three missions of Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. One very important mission of Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was imparting knowledge. It is mentioned in the hadith, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself said, Bu'istu mu'alliman. I am sent as a teacher. The outstanding quality of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was to be a teacher, teaching the people the Quran, teaching the people the Sunnah, and bringing about a change and revolution in the lives of the people. Imparting knowledge and acquiring knowledge, it's a means of attaining the closeness to Almighty Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. In fact, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala mentions imparting knowledge and acquiring knowledge as a means of becoming an Allah wala, a person being close to Allah Ta'ala. See, Allah tells us in the Quran Kareem, Kunu Rabbaniyin bima kuntum tu'allimuna al-kitab wa bima kuntum tadrusun. Become a Rabbani, become an Allah wala, become a saintly person. And two prescriptions to become a saintly person. Tu'allimuna al-kitab. That is, you teach the kitab, that is the Quran and the Sunnah, wa bima kuntum tadrusun, and by you having dars of the Quran and the Hadith. It was the noble habit of the Sahaba. When any Sahabi used to open up a madrasa, Sahaba, great illustrious people, but when any one of them used to open up a madrasa and impart knowledge to a people, the other Sahaba used to pay special attention to those Sahaba and accord them with respect, dignity, and honor. In Bukhari Sharif, in the second volume in Kitab al-Maghazi, under the chapter of Babu Wufud al-Ash'ariyin wa Qudumi Ahli al-Yaman, one student of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud narrates, he says, Kunna julusan inda ibn Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he had a madrasa. He had students around him, teaching the people the Quran, teaching them the Hadith. So Al-Qamah, the famous student of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, says, once we are sitting in a madrasa, like how probably all of you are now sitting in a madrasa or a madrasa environment. So we were seated around Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Faja'a Khabbab ibn Arit, a very great illustrious Sahabi, Khabbab ibn Arit radiallahu ta'ala, who made great sacrifices for deen. Some of them mentioned that he was the sixth person to have accepted Islam. And he bore a lot of oppression and persecution. He came specifically, took out time to come and meet the Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and the student of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He came to a madrasa environment. Then he told the principal, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, أَيَسْتَتِيُ هَاُولَيْ شَبَابْ أَيَّقْرَأْ كَمَا تَقْرَأْ. Are all these youngsters able to read the Qur'an al-Kareem like how you read the Qur'an al-Kareem? Apparently, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu was an expert in the recitation of the Qur'an al-Kareem. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala did not brag. He told to Abdullah ibn to Khabbab ibn Arid that إِنْ شِيْتَ أَمَرْتُ بَعْضُمْ أَيَّقْرَأْ. If you want, you take the exam, like how in a Jalsa, normally you get students read this, read that, and then the potential of the student is exemplified before the public. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu told, if you want, I'll tell one more student to read. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud told one student from that madrasa, Al-Qama, to read the Qur'an al-Kareem. And Al-Qama recited 50 verses of Surah Maryam. Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud asked Khabbab, كَيْفَ قَرَأَ. This student of mine who read in a madrasa, how did he read? What's your observation about his recitation? So Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala, who was a visitor, he came to observe the student. He said, Ahsan, it is very beautiful. From this we also understand when people attend a madrasa and when you observe some great potential of a madrasa, then you should comment, you should make statement, you say, mashallah, what beautiful education, appreciate the teachers, appreciate the knowledge that we imparted, value the people and appreciate the madrasa. Most respected elders and friends, there are four groups of people that contribute towards the success of a madrasa. The first group of people, students. Second group of people are the teachers. Third group of the people are the parents. And the fourth group of people is the management. Now, from the four groups, the most important group in a madrasa, in an environment of a madrasa, are the students. If you don't have students, there's not going to be any madrasa. What are we going to teach if there's no students? There are no takers for our knowledge. If a person has skill for farming, he's got the financial means, he's got the skill of farming, he's got all the financial ability to start off a farm, but he's got no land. So where will he put his skill there? Where will he put his money on? The students of a madrasa, they have presented the land to us to sow the seed of Iman and to cultivate it with values of Iman. So we should value our children and we should appreciate our children. Remember, most respected elders and parents, the world of today, remember, the world of today is an expression of the children of yesterday. What the children of yesterday were, this is the world that we are living today. And the world of tomorrow is actually the children of today. If we nurture our children with Islamic values, we will see a revolution in, and we will see the Islamization in our environment, in our area. Inculcate Islamic values, Islamic philosophy, Islamic ideology in our children. Ideally, we would want to make our children hafizes. We want to make our children ulama. We want to make them muftis. But the least, our target for now in a madrasa is to make our children among the salihin. It is not necessary that a child become a hafiz or an alim or a qari, but what is necessary, at least our child become a sincere, devout, dedicated Muslim. So after this education gets in a madrasa, any way the child go in the world, he lives with Islamic values and principles. The second group of important people in a madrasa are the teachers, the ulama. MashaAllah, I heard that this institute, Inc., it has a lot of ulama, and MashaAllah, very devoted, dedicated ulama, making great amount of effort and sacrifice in imparting the knowledge. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala accept their efforts, accept their sacrifices. Remember, always understand and be conscious of the value and the virtue of the ulama. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reported to have mentioned, al-ulama warathatul anbiya. The ulama, the people who have the knowledge of the Qur'an, the people that have the knowledge of the hadith, the people that have knowledge of fiqh, they've spent 7 years, 8 years, 9 years sacrificing their times in harsh environment and acquiring this knowledge. And today, they are in your midst and imparting about knowledge. So do not just look at that. Look at the sacrifice they made behind the present situation. They are the heirs of the prophets. In one hadith, Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala is reported to have mentioned, "Kunu aliman, O muta'alliman, O muhibban." If you can become an alim, do so. And if you can't become an alim, at least become a student of deen. And if you cannot do that, then at least love the ulama. And the fourth statement he mentioned elsewhere, do not become a fourth one, that do not become a person that hated the ulama. So it is very, very important that we value our ulama, understand the maqam and the position and the sacrifices they are making. Yes, of course, I would also like to advise the ulama. From my 30 years of experience in teaching, I'm still in the field of education. One is to impart knowledge, but the other is to show love. I advise the ulama, I advise my friends and my colleagues. I tell all my students, it is more important to give students love than imparting knowledge. You remember, I repeat this. It is more important to impart love. Give love, give care, give affection to the children. That is more important than merely imparting knowledge. Yes, the children will come to you to impart knowledge. But what they will remember in life, not only the knowledge, as they grow up, they'll read the Quran, they'll read the books, they will also acquire their own knowledge, but they'll remember your attitude. They'll remember the love and the care. When the child comes to the madrasa, ask him, did you eat food? How are you? Give him a smile. Sometimes he may have a bad day, or probably he's coming from an environment that is quite toxic. You become like the parent of the child. Show the child the love and the care. Our ulama have stated that until and unless a teacher does not treat the student like his own blood child, like his own biological child, you have not done justice to a student. And one thing I would really emphasize, no teacher should express anger on the child. Yes, be firm. Get the knowledge, get the work out of the child. But do not express anger on the child. Show the child a lot of care, a lot of love. Tolerate. Yes, the child may do something wrong, but as the child grows up, he'll realize he did something wrong, he'll have greater value for you. But if you are going to show anger to the child and you're going to ill-treat the child, he's going to start resenting the Quran, he's going to resent the hadith, he's going to resent the madrasa environment, and you are going to be responsible. Nevertheless, I really value and I appreciate the great efforts and sacrifices the ulama are making at Inc. May Allah accept the efforts and the sacrifices. The third group of people that are very important for the success of a madrasa are the parents themselves. The parents, it is farz upon them to educate the children and inculcate in them values of the Quran, Hadith and Islam. Remember, our children are an amanat. Our children are a trust. And we have to leave a legacy of Quran, Hadith and the Islamic thinking in them. We are going to leave the dunya. They are the one that's going to read for us. They are the one that's going to make dua for us. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam reported to mention, إِذَا مَاتَ إِبْنُ آدَمُ إِنْ قَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ. When a person passes away, everything terminates with the exception of three. The first, صَدْقَ جَارِيَة. When a person gives charity, that has recurring benefits and then recurring reward as well. For example, contributing to the madrasa, or contributing to a masjid, contributing to something through which the ummah benefits continuously. Second, knowledge that is beneficial. This is what is imparted in the Inc. Institute. It is knowledge. This is what is going to help you in your qabr and akhirat. And the third, waladin salihin yad'u lahu. You leave a child that will make dua for you. So our children, we put the Islamic values in them. Tomorrow we leave, we go in the qabr, we go in the akhirat, they will lift up their hands, Allah, my beloved parents imparted knowledge for me. They educated, they were the silent soldiers behind what I am today. I'm lifting my hands because they taught me about you. They taught me about the Quran. They taught me the hadith. They were behind this value system. Allah, you forgive them. And the fourth important group of people that take part in the success of a madrasa is the management. There may be one of the ulama, the parent, the student, but there are many silent soldiers behind the success of a madrasa, and that is the management. There are other people that love the madrasa. They want to see the success of the madrasa. The effort and devotion and dedication behind the success of the madrasa. Allah Ta'ala tells in the Quran Kareem, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Help and assist one another in acts of virtue and taqwa. This in madrasa environment is giving you this opportunity to contribute and help in act of virtue and taqwa. If this madrasa was not there, you would not have that opportunity. Now that the madrasa is there, it is an opportunity for you to invest. Whenever there's a business scheme, when there's an opportunity to invest, so you will only invest if there's an opportunity. If there's no opportunity, you're not going to invest. The Madrasa Inc. is giving you, the people of Baltimore, an ideal opportunity to make your investment for the akhirah. Appreciate this madrasa and value this madrasa. Allah tells us in the Quran Kareem, Kunu Ansar Allah. Become the helpers of the deen of Allah. And remember, when you are helping the deen of Allah, you are helping the madrasa, you are not doing any favor to a madrasa. The madrasa is doing a favor to you by giving you up an opportunity to die in the state of iman and make investment for the akhirah. Allah tells us in the Quran Kareem, In tansurullaha yansurkum wa yuthabbit aqdamakum. If you help the deen of Allah, Allah will help you. And Allah will keep your feet firm. Ulama mentioned any person that helps the deen of Allah in any way, and especially when it comes to imparting knowledge and a madrasa, then inshallah such people will die in the state of iman. What a beautiful opportunity for us to give our heart and soul to the madrasa. Help the madrasa. So you help the madrasa in various ways. Sometimes you could help the madrasa financially. You can help the madrasa by giving advices. You can help the madrasa by making dua. Or at least come to the principal. Go to Mufti Abdullah Ejaz. Go to the Asatiza and ask them, how's the madrasa running? What can I do for you? Sometimes you may not do something. You can encourage others to do it. And you make things easy for the running of the madrasa. And let me just give you one example, and shortly I will terminate after that. You see, one is the madrasa. One of the students, inshallah, they would get the pleasure of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And the ultimate pleasure of Allah is to go into Jannah. But if you help and assist the court of the madrasa, inshallah, where the ulama and the student of the madrasa will reach into Jannah, you too will reach into Jannah by linking yourself up to the madrasa. I normally give this example. In India, you have the train. You get the first class train and you get the third class train. The first class train, it is very expensive. It has soft seats. It has aircon. It is expensive. And the third class, hard seats, no aircon. It is cheaper. There was once a debate between the first class and the third class. So the first class told to a third class, the coach, you know, I'm more superior than you because all the rich and wealthy people, they sit in me. My seats are soft. I got AC condition in me. And my prices is more expensive than yours. And your coach, little hard seats, poor people come to you. People are not in comfort and luxury. So this is how the first class bragged it to the third class. The third class replied to a first class and told the first class, what you are saying is 100% correct. You are indeed more superior in terms of your AC, your soft seats, the price is more expensive. I am nowhere near you. But one thing for sure, that whatever is your destination is my destination. I am linked up to you. I'm the third class, you in the first class, I'm linked up to you, I'm in the third coach, I'm still linked up to you. Wherever the train goes, I'm also going to reach the same destination. If you're reaching Delhi, I'll also reach Delhi. It's not that I'm the third coach, so I won't reach Delhi. Exactly like that. In a madrasa, you get people that are more important. The ulama are important. The student are important. But you as a person that's not an alim, you're not a student, but you link yourself to a madrasa. If this madrasa, it seeks the rahmat and the pleasure of Allah and take the people to Jannah, by linking yourself, you're also going to Jannah and paradise. Lastly, I just want to make just two observations. You know, it was last year, this time, I was in Turkey. And I happened to go to the Suleymaniye Masjid in Turkey. I needed to do some mutala. Wherever I go somewhere, I always carry my kitab and my fatawa. So I spent about 3 hours in Suleymaniye Masjid, and I was marking some fatawa and preparing some work of mine. So after Maghrib Salat, as I was coming down, I had to walk down a long alley. I had my kitabs in my side, and as I was going down, I saw a group of people. Every shopkeeper was out of his shop, and everyone is holding my hand and telling me, brother, come in my shop, come in my shop, come in my shop. I could have reached the end of the road in about 5 minutes, but it took me about half an hour. Everyone is holding my hand and telling me, come in my shop, come in my shop. And I thought on this and I reflected that these shopkeepers, they've got the wealth of this world. They've got commodities in them. How much of effort, how much of sacrifice they are making to ensure that I have come into their shop. There must be a buyer. Just come into the shop. So at least I could see. Many of them told me that, uncle, you don't have to buy. Just come and look. I promise you don't have to buy. They want me just to come in the shop. And obviously, when I look at the shop, I look at the environment, I would be enticed to buy. And I thought to myself, these people are making so much of effort to impart the dunya. How much of effort we should be making to impart deen? We've got something more valuable in our madrasas. How much effort are we making to impart this knowledge? So I urge every single one of you, talk about this madrasa. Tell the people of the madrasa. Tell them the values of the madrasa. And just as shopkeepers want the people to come into their shop, you get people to come and join this madrasa. Inshallah, there'll be a lot of khair. One person is guided through you. You guided somebody to come to a madrasa. That person today will be learned the Quran, Hadith. He may become a hafiz, alim, etc. All that sawab-e jariya is for you. And last observation I'll make before I conclude. Again, it was an incident in Turkey. I needed to take a ship to go to Bursa. One is in Istanbul, and from Istanbul, I needed to take a ship. I needed to go to Bursa. So after buying the ticket, myself and the family, we were there by the docks. It was quite a windy day. So I observed that ship. After going in the ship, I realized what a beautiful ship it was. But as I was standing outside, I saw it was a windy day, and the ship was rocking heavily on the right, on the left, on the right, on the left. But obviously, it was tied up with a rope to the dock. And I thought to myself, if that ship, such a beautiful ship, if it was not tied up to the docks, then it would have been sailed somewhere in the center of the ocean, and nobody would have valued it. Soon thereafter, the captain went, and then when they released that ship, the captain was able to navigate the ship to the other side of the ocean, to Bursa. And I thought to myself that every one of us got so many values in us. If we don't tie ourselves to some ulama, we don't tie ourselves to a spiritual guide, we don't tie ourselves to a sheikh, to get some spiritual guidance, in that case, it may just be like that beautiful ship that's not tied down. It can just go away, somewhere in the ocean. It can get lost somewhere in the ocean. But if you've got somebody to captain your life, then they will direct you on the correct path of life towards Allah and the Rasul. And this is exactly what is the purpose of this Madrasa Inc., where the purpose is imparting knowledge, imparting spirituality, and directing the people towards Allah and the Rasul and the Ridwan and the pleasure of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. In conclusion, I make dua that Almighty Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala accept this Institute of Inc. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala bless it with qubuliyat and barakah. Allah accept the effort and the sacrifices of the founder, Mufti Abdullah Ejaz, Hafidahullah, and all the asatidah, the ulama that are there. Allah accept all the students. Allah accept the parents. Allah accept the many silent soldiers behind the establishment and the running of the madrasa. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make it a means of his ridwan and his pleasure. Remember, Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam taught us this one dua. Allahumma inna nas'aluka ilman nafi'a wa amalan mutaqabbala wa rizqan halalan tayyiba wa shifa'an min kulli da. Oh Allah, you grant me beneficial knowledge. Knowledge alone is not sufficient, but amal, practicing on the dictate of the knowledge and the amal must be maqbool. And may Allah grant us halal, tayyib, rizq, and shifa. One is physical shifa, like in the time of the pandemic. May Allah grant everyone shifa, and Allah remove this pandemic from us. And one is spiritual shifa, where our heart is brimming with the ridwan and the love of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. May Allah grant every one of us husn al-khatima, and grant us the ridwan of Allah, and the pleasure of Allah, wa ridwanu min Allahi akbar, wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazaakallahu Khaira wa ahsana jaza Mufti Sahib for your time. MashaAllah, Mufti Sahib is extremely busy with all of his different endeavors. So we really appreciate Mufti Sahib that you were able to speak to us for a few minutes. Alhamdulillah, I benefited tremendously. And as I know that every single person listening also benefited tremendously. So once again, Jazaakallahu Khaira Mufti Sahib for your time.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Jazakallah Mufti Abdullah Sahib, and may Allah accept all your efforts and sacrifices. And salam to all the people that are participating in the program. And I normally tell the people, when people take part in these kind of jalsas, then this is a means of your support to a madrasa, and it is better than thousands of rakat of nafil namaz. It is better than lots of your nafil ibadat, because you are supporting and you are contributing towards an institute of Deen and Islam, through which Deen and Islam will become alive, inshallah.
Ameen.
So assalam to everybody, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Ameen. Jazakallah Mufti Sahib. Please pass our salams to Apa as well. MashaAllah, Apa is Mufti Ibrahim's wife, and she, you know, was very supportive and facilitated our stay at the Al-Iftah as well tremendously. So please pass our salams to her as well, inshallah.
Ameen. I will definitely, inshallah. And salams to everybody there.
Ji, inshallah. Jazakallah khair Mufti Sahib.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Alhamdulillah, Jazakallah Khair for all the programs. And to wrap it up, inshallah, we call on Qari Muhammad Zahid to make the closing dua. Inshallah, Qari Zahid is my Hifz teacher and someone who is local to the Baltimore area. Wallahu Adam, I'm not too sure if there's a single family in the area that is not aware of Qari Muhammad Zahid and his dedication to the services of the Qur'an and the khidmat of the Qur'an. So Qari Sahib, bismillah, after sheaf line or kuch lamhe ke liye hame inshallah saadat farmaye inshallah.
Hello
ji, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Awaaz aa rahi
ji? Ji,
acha. To assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi wabarakatuh. تو سب سے پہلے تو گزارش یہ ہے کہ میں ایک طالب علم کی حیثیت سے حاضر ہوا اور مفتی عبداللہ نے مجھے مطلب یہ درخواست کی کہ بھئی آپ دعا کریں. تو میں نے کبھی آپ کے پاس تو ماشاءاللہ بڑے بڑے علماء اور مفتی صاحب کا بھی میں نے بیان سنا بھی. اللہ پاک ہمیں اس کو سمجھ کر عمل کرنے کی توفیق عطا فرمائے ہم سب کو, اور اللہ پاک بہت برکتیں فرمائے. تو دعا کے لیے انہوں نے مجھے حکم دیا تو میں اس لیے حاضر ہوا کہ یہ کام تو ایسا ہے کہ آدمی اپنے اللہ سے مانگتا ہے, اپنے لیے بھی مانگتا ہے اور سب کے لیے بھی مانگتا ہے. اور مقال ہمارے حضرت شیخ قاری فتح محمد صاحب رحمۃ اللہ علیہ وہ فرماتے تھے کہ جب بھی آپ اللہ سے مانگو تو بس یہ یقین کر کے مانگا کرو کہ ہم اللہ سے جو مانگیں گے اللہ عافیت کے ساتھ اس میں خیر عطا فرمائیں گے اور اللہ پاک ضرور قبول فرمائیں گے. اور فرماتے تھے کہ بھائی ایک بچہ بھی اپنی ماں سے جو بات منوانی ہو تو وہ رو دھو کے کسی بھی طریقے سے ماں کو منوائی لیتا ہے. تو اللہ پاک تو ہمیں سب سے زیادہ محبت کرتے ہیں, تو اس لیے دعا میں ایک تو یہ یقین رکھیں کہ اللہ پاک ضرور قبول فرمائیں گے, ہر خیر کی دعا اللہ قبول فرمائیں گے اور اس میں عافیت والا معاملہ فرمائیں گے. تو انشاءاللہ میری گزارش تو مفتی عبداللہ صاحب سے یہ تھی کہ مفتی ابراہیم دیسائی صاحب سے ہی کلوزنگ دعا کرائیں, یا تو کیونکہ मगर इन्होंने कहा कि नहीं जी आपकी शिरकत हो जाए तो मैं सिर्फ इसलिए शिरकत भी मैंने करनी थी, अगर दुआ ना भी होती तो दुआ इसलिए कर रहा हूँ कि शायद मेरा कोई हिस्सा हो इस इदारे में और अल्लाह सुबहानहू व तआला इसको भी और तमाम दीनी इदारों को कबूल फरमाए और मैं एक तालिबे इल्म की हैसियत से हमारी शिरकत को अल्लाह कबूल फरमाए और मेरा हिस्सा इसमें पड़ जाए इंशाल्लाह। तो दुआ करते हैं इंशाल्लाह अल्लाह इसको कबूल फरमाए। اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية والمعافاة الدائمة في الدنيا والآخرة والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار. اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا، اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا، اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا، وأكرمنا ولا تهنا، وأعطنا ولا تحرمنا، اللهم أكرمنا ولا تهنا، اللهم أكرمنا ولا تهنا، وأعطنا ولا تحرمنا. اے اللہ ہمارے تمام صغیرہ کبیرہ گناہوں کو معاف فرما، اے اللہ ہم سے محبت فرما، اپنے سے محبت کرنے کی توفیق عطا فرما، اے اللہ جس دین کے لیے صحابہ تابعین تبع تابعین تمام اکابرین نے محنت مشقت اٹھا کر قربانیاں دے کر ہم تک یہ دین پہنچایا اور اے اللہ آپ نے ہمیں قبول فرمایا، اے اللہ آپ نے ہمیں قبول فرمایا، ورنہ بغیر آپ کی محبت آپ کی رضا مندی اور آپ کی قبولیت کے ہم کہاں اس دین کو پڑھنے اور پڑھانے والے ہوتے. اے اللہ جب آپ نے ہمیں قبول فرمایا تو اے اللہ اس کو اپنی شان کے مطابق حد درجہ قبول فرما اور ہماری کمی کوتاہیوں کو معاف فرما. اے اللہ ہمارے تمام دینی اداروں کی حفاظت فرما، اے اللہ ان کو قبول فرما، اور اے اللہ خاص طور پر اے اللہ ان میں جو بچے پڑھ رہے ہیں جو بچیاں اے اللہ پڑھ رہے ہیں ان کو قبول فرما، اور اے اللہ تمام اساتذہ کو ان کی محنتوں پر ان کے درجات کو بلند فرما، اے اللہ ہر درجہ قبول فرما. اے اللہ اس ادارے سے بھی اور تمام دینی اداروں سے جو ہمارے بچے پڑھ کر جائیں تو اے اللہ وہ دین کی شمع کو دنیا کے کونے کونے میں روشن کریں، اور اے اللہ جو بھی اس میں غلطیاں کوتاہیاں ہو جائے کریں معاف فرما. اے اللہ انک اس ادارے کو دن 10 گنا رات 1000 گنا ترقی عطا فرما، اے اللہ ترقی عطا فرما. اے اللہ اس ادارے کے بھی اور اے اللہ تمام دینی اداروں کی ہر شر سے ہر برائی سے ہر مصیبت سے ہر تکلیف سے حفاظت فرما، اے اللہ ہر تکلیف سے حفاظت فرما. اے اللہ شیطان کے شر سے کفر کے مکر سے ہم تمام کی حفاظت فرما. اے اللہ ہمارے بچوں کو دیندار بنا، جیسا کہ مفتی صاحب نے فرمایا کہ اللہ عالم حافظ بن کر اے اللہ اگر دیندار نہ رہے تو بیکار ہو گیا. اے اللہ ہم سب کو ہمارے تمام بچوں کو دین کی سمجھ عطا فرما، اے اللہ ان کو حافظ بنا کر عالم بنا کر دین کی سمجھ عطا فرما کر ان کو دیندار بنا. اے اللہ ہم سب کو دین پر عمل کرنے والا بھی بنا اور دین کو آگے تک پہنچانے والا بھی بنا. اے اللہ اخلاص کے ساتھ پڑھنے پڑھانے والا بنا، اور اے اللہ اخلاص کے ساتھ اور اے اللہ عاجزی سے رہتے ہوئے اے اللہ اس دین کی خدمت کرنے کی توفیق عطا فرما. اے اللہ قرآن میں ساری زندگی ہمیں لگائے رکھنا نصیب فرما. اے اللہ جس طرح ہمارے اکابرین نے ہمارے بڑوں نے اے اللہ بچپن سے لے کے آج تک ہمیں کسی بھی طرح اس کام میں لگایا ہوا ہے، اور اے اللہ بغیر آپ کی نصرت کے اور آپ کے فضل کے اور آپ کے احسان کے آپ کے کرم کے ہم نہیں لگ سکتے تھے. اے اللہ جس طرح ہمارے بڑے ہمیں لگا کے چلے گئے، اے اللہ آخری سانس تک ہمیں اس دین کی خدمت کرنے کی توفیق عطا فرما. اے اللہ اخلاص کے ساتھ سنت کے طریقے پر اے اللہ اس دین پر چلنے والا بنا، اور اے اللہ اس دین کی محنت کرنے والا بنا. اے اللہ قرآن کو سمجھ کر اور اے اللہ اس کو آگے پہنچانے والا بنا. اے اللہ ہمارے بچوں کو بھی قبول فرما. اے اللہ ہمارے پاس جو جو بھی شاگرد پڑھنے آئے اے اللہ اس کو قبول فرما، اے اللہ اس کو قبول فرما. اے اللہ ہمارے نسلوں کی ایمان کی حفاظت فرما. اے اللہ اس مبارک موقع پر اے اللہ ہمارے اکابرین نے جتنی بھی خیر کی دعائیں مانگی وہ تمام خیریں عطا فرما، اور اے اللہ جتنے شرور سے پناہ مانگی ان تمام شرور سے ہماری بھی اور تمام امت مسلمہ کی حفاظت فرما. اے اللہ ہمارے اساتذہ کو جزائے خیر عطا فرما. اے اللہ ہمارے اساتذہ کو ہمارے والدین کو جزائے خیر عطا فرما. اے اللہ جو دنیا سے جا چکے اور اے اللہ ہم پر بڑی محنتیں کر کے وہ دنیا سے جا چکے، اے اللہ ان کی قبروں کو جنت کا باغ بنا. اے اللہ ان کی قبروں پر رحمت کا کرم کا معاملہ فرما. اے اللہ ان پر فضل کا احسان کا معاملہ فرما. اے اللہ ان کی قبروں کو جنت کا باغ بنا. اللهم اجعل قبورهم روضة من رياض الجنة. اے اللہ ہمارے والدین میں سے ہمارے اساتذہ میں سے جو دنیا میں موجود ہیں اے اللہ ان کو لمبی زندگی صحت والی عافیت والی عطا فرما اور ان کا سایہ ان کا شفیق سایہ ہمارے سروں پر قائم و دائم فرما. اے اللہ حال ہی میں ہمارے بہت سے اساتذہ ہمارے بہت سے ساتھی آپ کے پاس آ چکے ہیں سب کی مغفرت فرما. اے اللہ ان کی قربانیوں کو قبول فرما جہاں کمی کوتاہی ہو گئے معاف فرما. اے اللہ ہمیں معاف فرما. اے اللہ اپنی شان کے مطابق ہم سے محبت فرما. اے اللہ حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی ہر ہر سنت کو زندہ کرنے والا بنا ہر ہر سنت پر مر مٹنے والا بنا. اے اللہ صحابہ کے نقش قدم پر چلا. اے اللہ ہمیں ادخلوا فی السلم کافہ کا مصداق بنا. اے اللہ ہمیں 100% اسلام میں داخل فرما. اے اللہ ہمیں 100% اے اللہ 100% ہمیں صحیح معنوں میں مسلمان بنا. اے اللہ اپنا فرما بردار بنا ہماری اولادوں کو بھی. اے اللہ اپنا فرما بردار بنا. اے اللہ ہمارے نسلوں کی ایمان کی حفاظت فرما. اے اللہ کوئی پتہ آپ کے حکم کے بغیر نہیں ہل سکتا تو اے اللہ ہم یہاں آئے اے اللہ آپ کے حکم سے آئے. اے اللہ ہمارے دین کی ہمارے نسلوں کی ایمان کی حفاظت فرما. اور اے اللہ جیسے مفتی صاحب نے فرمایا کہ بڑوں سے اے اللہ ہم اگر بندھے رہے اپنے آپ کو ان کے ساتھ اے اللہ متوجہ کرتے رہے اور اے اللہ بڑوں کی شفقت کے سائے میں رہے تو اے اللہ ہم کامیاب رہیں گے. اے اللہ ہمارے بچوں کی اس کی توفیق عطا فرما کہ کسی نہ کسی نیک اے اللہ صالح پر صالح سے اللہ اس کو وابستہ بنا. اے اللہ اس کو وابستہ بنا. اے اللہ ہم جو مانگ سکے وہ بھی عطا فرما جو نہیں مانگ سکے اپنی شاعر شان عطا فرما. اے اللہ ہمیں مانگنا بھی نہیں آتا اے اللہ ہمیں مانگنے کا وہ ڈھنگ عطا فرما وہ طریقہ عطا فرما جو آپ کو پسند ہو. اے اللہ ہاتھ یہ اٹھے یہ بھی آپ کے حکم سے اٹھے. اے اللہ ہمیں مانگنا نہیں آتا بن مانگے عطا فرما. اے اللہ اپنی شاعر شان عطا فرما. اے اللہ جب تک ہم دنیا میں موجود ہیں اے اللہ آخری سانس تک قرآن کی خدمت میں لگائے رکھنا نصیب فرما. اے اللہ جب دنیا سے جانے کا وقت ہو اے اللہ ہمارا اسی حال میں خاتمہ فرما جیسا ہم نے اپنے اساتذہ کو دیکھا کہ دنیا سے وہ پڑھتے پڑھاتے ہوئے اخلاص کی بنیاد پر چلے گئے اور آپ کے پاس آ گئے. اے اللہ ہمیں بھی ان کے نقش قدم پر چلاتے ہوئے اے اللہ آخری سانس تک اخلاص کے ساتھ اے اللہ اخلاص کے ساتھ سنت کے طریقے پر چلتے ہوئے اے اللہ ہمیں لگائے رکھنا نصیب فرما. اے اللہ یقیناً ہم بہت چھوٹے ہیں کمزور ہیں ضعیف ہیں. اے اللہ آپ نے فرمایا کہ میں نے تمہیں کمزور پیدا کیا خلق الانسان ضعیفا. اے اللہ ہم بہت کمزور ہیں. اے اللہ ہمیں قوی بنا. اے اللہ ہمیں طاقتور بنا. اے اللہ ہمیں طاقتور بنا. اور اے اللہ ہماری ہر ہر لمحے کو اے اللہ ہمارے ہر ہر لمحے کو دین کے لیے قبول فرما. اے اللہ دین کے لیے قبول فرما. اے اللہ ہمارے بچوں کو قبول فرما. اے اللہ ہماری بچیوں کو قبول فرما. اے اللہ جو ہم سے پڑھ کے جا چکے ان کے بھی دین کی ایمان کی حفاظت فرما. اور اے اللہ جو آنے والے ہیں اے اللہ ان کی بھی دین کی حفاظت فرما. اے اللہ جو پڑھ رہے ہیں اے اللہ ان کی بھی ایمان کی دین کی حفاظت فرما. اے اللہ مخلص لوگوں کو مخلص حضرات کو اے اللہ اس طرح متوجہ فرما. اے اللہ یہ انک ادارہ جو کھلا ہے اور اے اللہ ایک سال کا عرصہ گزرا ہے اے اللہ اس کو قیامت تک اس کو بھی اور تمام دینی اداروں کو اے اللہ اپنی اپنی نصرت فرماتے ہوئے اپنا فضل فرماتے ہوئے قیامت تک جاری و ساری فرما. اے اللہ علم کی شمع کو ان اداروں سے اے اللہ ہمیشہ روشن فرما. اے اللہ اس کو بجھنے نہ فرما. اللہم انا سلک علما نافعا ورزقا واسعا وعملا صالحا متقبلا ولسانا ذاکرا شاکرا. اللہم انا نعوذ بک من علم لا ينفع. اللہم انا نعوذ بک من علم لا ينفع. اللهم انا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ونعوذ بك من عين لا تدمع ومن نفس لا تشبع. اللهم انا نعوذ بك من دعاء لا يستجاب لها. اے اللہ ہماری دعاؤں کو قبول و منظور فرما. اے اللہ جو ہم نے مانگا وہ بھی عطا فرما جو نہیں مانگا ہم نے اے اللہ اپنی شان کے مطابق عطا فرما. اے اللہ اس ادارے میں جتنے حضرات متوجہ ہیں چاہے وہ اپنے وقت سے اپنے مال سے اور اپنی جان سے اور اپنی دعاؤں سے جس طرح بھی اس ادارے کی اے اللہ وہ نصرت فرما رہے ہیں اے اللہ ان کی جان میں مال میں اولاد میں برکت عطا فرما. اے اللہ تمام اساتذہ کو اے اللہ حد درجہ قبول فرما. اے اللہ ان کی جان اولاد مال میں برکت عطا فرما. اے اللہ یقیناً آپ دعاؤں کو قبول فرماتے ہیں. اے اللہ عافیت کے ساتھ بلائی بہتری کے ساتھ اے اللہ ہماری دعاؤں کو قبول و منظور فرما. اللہم انا نسألک من خیر ما سألک من نبیک محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وانت المستعان وعليك البلاغ ولا حول ولا قوه الا بالله العلي العظيم وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه سيدنا محمد واله واصحابه اجمعين امين برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين. Jazaakumullahu Khaira, Mufti sahab, bahut bahut mubarak ho, mashallah.
Jazaakallahu Khaira, Kareem sahab, aapke waqt ke liye, duaon ke liye. Alhamdulillah. Jazaakallahu Khaira.
Jazaakumullahu,
inshaAllah. Alhamdulillah, we're wrapping up the program. We thank Qari Muhammad Zahid, Barakaatuhu, for his time, for his continuous support, du'as and advice, as well as Mufti Azimuddin Ahmed, who spoke to us for a few minutes in the beginning. And lastly, Mufti Ibrahim Desai, Barakaatuhu, wa damallahu fiyudahu, for his continued support, advice, and du'as. May Allah accept from all of us, grant all of us ikhlas, istiqama, qubuli, and afiyah. InshaAllah, the admissions will begin in mid-August for the new year. Alhamdulillah, we call it a close for the academic year of 2019-2020. May Allah grant all of the parents, all of the students, and all of the teachers the best in dunya and akhirah. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu.